Hello everybody. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Anne Walsh Donnelly, and I'm delighted to be able to read tonight, this special night where we are honouring Eavan Boland. So I want to thank Sandy and Elizabeth Ann for having me back again on here. I was on 2 weeks ago and here I am again. So the first poem I want to read is one by Eavan Boland, and it's called And Love. And Soul, sorry. And she wrote it the summer her mother was dying, and it was one of the wettest summers on record here in Ireland. And she was travelling back and forth across Dublin City to see her mother while she was dying. And she was reflecting on water and reflecting on dying and how the body disintegrates and goes back to the elements it was composed of. So here it is. It's called And Soul by Eavan Boland. My mother died one summer, the wettest in the records of the state. Crops rotted in the west, checked tablecloths dissolved in back gardens, empty deck chairs collected rain. As I took my way to her, through traffic, through lilacs dripping blackly, behind houses, and on curbsides, to pay her the last tribute of a daughter. I thought of something I remembered I heard once, that the body is, or is said to be, almost all water. And as I turned southward, that ours is a city of it, one in which every single day the elements begin a journey towards each other that will never, given our weather, fail. The ocean, visible in the edges cut by it, cloud colour reaching into air, the Liffey storing one and summoning the other, salt greeting the lack of it at the north wall. And as if that wasn't enough, all of it ending up almost every evening inside our speech. Coast, canal, ocean, river, stream, and now, mother. And I drove on, and although the mind is unreliable in grief, at the next cloudburst it almost seemed they could be shades of each other. The way the body is, of every one of them, and now they are on the move again. Fog into mist, mist into sea spray, and boat into the oily glaze that lay on the railings of the house she was dying in as I went inside. So that's for Eavan Boland and her family. My mother's actually a year older than Eavan Boland. Thankfully, she's still with me. But I've been thinking all week, especially of Eavan's family and her daughters. I never had the privilege of meeting her, but Domestic Violence was one of the first books I read when I started writing poetry a couple of years ago. So I think, all poets, particularly women poets in Ireland, have a lot to be thankful for. And now I'm trying to follow that with some of my own poems. I'm going to read another poem of Evans later on, and I kind of feel quite humbled now after reading that to try and follow it with some of my own poems. But I am going to try. I'm going to read from my chapbook, The Woman with an Owl Tattoo. And the first poem I'm going to read is a poem called Cuchulainn, and it's based on the Irish mythical Celtic warrior called Cuchulainn. There's a story about Cuchulainn where he goes to visit a chieftain, and there's a big guard dog guarding the chieftain's compound, and he threatens to attack Cuchulainn. So Cuchulainn gets his hurl and his slither, which is a ball, and basically kills the hound with the ball. And then he takes the hound's place until a new hound can be raised to guard the compound. He takes the hound's place. So that story prompted me to write a poem about my own journey in terms of my leaving my marriage and having to guard my children as a result of leaving it. So here it is, Cuchulainn. In midlife, I grew into my childhood hero. I stood in the hound's shadow, its paws like circular saw blades, poised, ready to maul. I gripped my hurley in one hand, slither in the other, wished it was only a mythical dog I had to kill. The hound's jaws were prized apart by verbal battles and eggshell silences. Its hot breath raised blisters on my skin. I whacked the sitter down its gullet, watched as the ball dragged the entrails of my marriage out the rear end. I grabbed his hind legs, smashed the body against the concrete wall, became sole guardian of the vulnerable, the ones I believed hound would always protect. Thank you. And the next poem I'm going to read is a bit more uplifting than that one, you'll be glad to hear. It's called Friesian. And I drew on a childhood memory of watching my dad pull a calf from a labouring cow, which was quite bloody. And I wanted to use that to talk about my own rebirth, which was quite difficult, but also it was very joyful. So here it's called Friesian. The new vet's perfume cut through the muck in the shed. She pulled on shoulder-length gloves, reached inside my best dairy cow, up to the birth canal. The animal roared like a chainsaw until a whoosh of blood, a Friesian calf slipped out. After the calf had suckled, I asked the new vet in for tea, released my copper highlighted hair from its ponytail while she washed. The first time we made love, her hands delivered me from my labour days. Like my Friesian calf, I landed on sweet smelling straw. So I sometimes use myths and I use images and fiction in my poetry. I remember somebody read that poem and said, "Oh, did you have an affair with a vet?" And I said, "No, I didn't." It was just basically using the image to talk about my own rebirth. The next poem I'm going to read is a poem I haven't actually read to an audience before. So it's called Ache of Naked Bodies. And I wrote it at a time when I think I was longing for something soft in my life. I think one of the things women in particular don't talk about is if you've lost a partner or a husband or wife through separation or through bereavement or whatever it is, one thing women don't talk about is how much you miss being with someone intimately, having sex, being in the bed naked beside someone. And that's something, you know, that I like to talk about and I like to write about. And in this poem, I think I was at a stage where I was longing for something. Ache of naked bodies. Yours and mine in the tall by mirror. Soaped skin, pliable as dough, rises. Coils, we braid our bodies. Perfume, yours and mine, embrace, seeps into our pores. Summer sighs escape from every orifice. We lick fingertips dipped in salmon flesh, knowing they feed our rare fusions. Thank you. The next poem I'm going to read is called Dublin Expressway. And this is another one where I just kind of went mad with my imagination. What I was thinking about when I wrote this was, what would it have been like for me if I had come out as being gay in my 20s and if I'd gone home to tell my parents that I was gay? Now, I didn't come out till I was gay, till I was in my 50s. But I was just kind of wondering, what would it have been like? And that was like back in the 1980s when homosexuality was a criminal offence here in Ireland. And you know, for a lot of us, being gay was not an option, and people like myself repressed it. So this was me imagining what might have been like. The Dublin Expressway. We'll stop outside the village post office. I'll alight, heave backpack over my shoulder. Unfinished essay on the rise of the suffragettes in its side pocket. Before I trudge the mile home, I'll stop into Betty's, buy you a packet of Benson and Hedges, an apology for not being down since Christmas. My new Doc Martens will burn the skin around my ankles as I walk. I'll pause and watch lambs leap over clumps of bulrushes in a field. Their mothers will glare and bleat. Shawnee, aboard his new tractor, will stop to offer a lift. I'll decline. When I open our farmyard gate, the cattle in the slatted house will low, pigs grunt. The smell of silage will make me nauseous. I'll be relieved if Dad is still at the mart. I'll leave backpack in the scullery, open the kitchen door. You'll say, "Hello, stranger," and continue to prick holes in the raw apple tart. I'll make a pot of tea. After you put the tart in the oven, I'll give you the cigarettes and say, "Ma'am, I want to tell you something." Your ash will fall on the flower table as I extract the overcooked words lodged in my gut. When I finish, the whir of the oven's electric fan will be the only sound to fill the room. You'll smoke 3 cigarettes in quick succession, tea going cold. Then you look out at the herd of clouds trampling across the sky. Cat will scratch the window pane and hiss when you open the window. Tell her to scat. Burnt pastry will pollute the air, sting our eyes. You'll grab a tea towel, yank the oven door, pull the apple tart out and dump it in the bin. You'll turn to me and say, "Well, at least you're not pregnant." Say nothing to your father, he hates waste. After a pause and wipe of your ploughed brow, you'll pick up the rolling pin and last lump of pastry. Thank you. And I'm going to read another poem by Eavan Boland. When I first read this, it really spoke to me, and you'll probably understand why when I read it or after I read it. It's called Heroic by Eavan Boland. Sex and history and skin and bone, and the oppression of Sunday afternoon. Bells call the faithful to devotion. I was still at school and on my own, and walked and walked and sheltered from the rain. The patriot was made of drenched stone. His lips were still speaking, the gun, he just had killed someone. I looked up and looked at him again. He stared past me without recognition. I moved my lips and wondered how the rain would taste if my tongue were made of stone, and wished it was, and whispered so that no one could hear him, hear me but him. Make me a heroine. So now to follow that with my own poem, and my poem is called No More Fairy Tales. And it's a similar theme in that when I was writing this, I was thinking very much of the historical role, I suppose, of women here in Ireland, the idea of being barefoot and tied to the kitchen sink, as my ex used to often say jokingly to me. And so again, I'm using story and fiction in this. When my book came out last year, The Woman with an Owl Tattoo, one of the main topics of conversation amongst some of my colleagues was, where is her tattoo? Is it on her arm or her shoulder or her ankle? I don't have a tattoo at all yet. But I was just using that image to convey something else, a deeper truth, I suppose. So this is called No More Fairy Tales. Tattooist inked the skin on my abdomen. A green dragon emerged, lounging in a balloon's wicker basket. He exhaled hot air upwards. The needle scratchy pain subsided as the balloon inflated and floated towards my breast. Your tail said dragons were dangerous. Mine kept me afloat in skies of dark dodging clouds and white water rapid rain. When Tattooist had finished, the dragon swallowed an X's once indelible name. In my story, I saved the princess. She tickles my balloon, palms the basket, licks my dragon's amber breath, without guarantee of a happy ever anything. Thank you. And one more poem before I go. I have no idea how long I'm on, but hopefully I haven't been on too long. This is the last poem in my chapbook, and it's called I Have Lived. And I wanted to end the chapbook on a positive note, and I suppose I want to end this reading too on a positive note, because I've actually found it quite emotional to be reading some of Eavan Boland's poems, and then to be reading my own as well, and trying to, you know, feel quite humbled. So this poem is upbeat. I think kind of one of the challenges at the moment we have is balancing the good stuff in life and the not so good stuff in life, and holding them in the same room. And I think this is kind of what I was trying to do with this poem, and looking forward then to whatever will come afterwards. So it's called I Have Lived, and it's a reflection really on my relationships with both men and women. I have lived in his body, grazed my hand on his stubbly head, lost myself in his rainforest armpits, sheltered under the ledge of his chin, roamed the plains of his chest like a nomad, swirled his jack janels in my mouth, ran with bulls through his fields of desire, oiled my iron walls to ease his entrance. I have lived in her body, grasped her bleach marin grass, surfed her peaks and troughs, licked maple syrup from her lips, bathed naked in her volcanic springs, settled my cheek on the inside of her thigh, sipped her dry gin, let her light a candle in my cave. What is there left to explore? And I hope there's loads of good things left to explore. And now, thank you so much for watching and listening. I hope you enjoy the rest of the evening. There's some fabulous poets coming up. I'm certainly looking forward to seeing them. So till we meet again, stay safe and keep well. God bless. Good night.